Welcome back to the Mr. Grom Show. I'm happy that you have come here to watch another episode of the show. I chose to change the format of the show a bit, making it a video instead of a live stream. I hope you will like it, and I hope you will appreciate it. Tonight we're going to talk about a couple of things that have taken place between today and previous episode. That is the EU Parliament re-election, the first US presidential debate between Joe Biden and Donald Trump, upcoming UK general elections, and the failure of Hollywood with Acolyte, aka a new Star Wars show. On June 6th to June 9th, millions of Europeans, as did yours truly, went to the polls to vote for their representative in the European Parliament. The results were surprising, to say the least. We witnessed the rise of right-wing and conservative parties all over Europe, from Lisbon to Helsinki. In the major European states such as France, the National Rally Party, headed by Marine Le Pen, won outright against Liberal Ensemble Party, i.e. the party of the incumbent French President Emmanuel Macron. Due to this, President Macron dissolved the National Assembly and announced a snap election. The election will take place on June 30th, with the first round, and on 7th of July for the second round of voting. Looking at the current polls, it is more than likely that National Rally will win a majority, and a right-wing government in France is not out of the picture. We saw a similar situation in Germany, where current ruling Social Democratic Party ended third in the EU Parliament election, with the center-right Christian Democrats CSU/CDU winning most of the votes, and right-wing Alternative for Germany ending second. This indicates the unpopularity of leftist ideas in Germany at this time. Surprisingly, this right-wing trend is also visible with the youth, as the AfD had a large supportive base among the young voters, which is a surprise as this voting bloc used to massively vote for the Greens. I guess we Gen Zers are young, but we aren't stupid. And we aren't stupid to vote for the leftist destructive ideals such as the Green New Deal, and opening our shorts to even more undocumented immigrants. Overall, looking at the parliamentary groupings as of June 30th, 2024, the biggest losers of the European parliamentary elections were the centre-left, the Progressive Alliance of Socialists and Democrats, who lost 3 seats, but are still second largest parliamentary group with 136 total seats. Next big losers are the Greens, who lost 17 seats and are second to smallest parliamentary groups in EU Parliament and now have only 54 seats. I wonder why that happened. Lastly, the biggest losers are the Liberal Renew Europe group, who lost 27 seats and have been demoted from 3rd to 4th largest EU group, now having only 75 seats, and they are the biggest losers of the night. The biggest winners in the election is the centre-right European People's Party group, who have won 12 seats and now have 188 seats and remain the biggest group in the European Parliament. The right-wing Conservative and Reformist group had a very good night, winning a total of 14 seats and becoming now the third largest group in the EU Parliament. The Eurosceptic, or how the media likes to call them, far-right Identity and Democracy group, has also had a good night, winning 9 seats and overtaking the Greens, with 58 seats won in total. I would also like to state that the current groupings in the European Parliament are a subject of change, as there are still 87 non-inscript members of the EU Parliament, and some could join either of the major groups, or there is a possibility of formation of a new group inside of the parliament. Anyways, looking at the current results, major changes in the EU institutions are unlikely, as coalition of EPP, Renew and SNDs is most likely going to happen again. However, there are some speculations being spread around that the current EU Commission President Ursula von der Leyen could invite conservative and reformists into the coalition due to their massive gains, but as of right now, it is still speculation. On June 27th, CNN hosted a first US presidential debate between two major party candidates, Joe Biden from Democrats and Donald Trump for the Republicans. I watched it, so you don't have to. I would have to say that my opinion inclines with the current position of the media, as for once they have not lied to us and are not hiding the facts that Joe Biden is too senile to run the country, aka the United States, judging by how bad the debate night went for him. Biden basically ended his campaign with the line, "We finally beat Medicare," which Trump used to criticize him even more for his handling of immigration, as did a high influx of migrants, social program, the quality of social programs and services have decreased due to its high demand from both citizens of the country and the migrants. One of the highlights of the debate, which is also worth mentioning, is the Trump quote, "I really don't know what he said," at the end of that sentence, and "I don't think he knows what he said either," which, to be honest, is the final nail to the coffin that is Biden's presidency. CNN, after debate, had a poll showing that surprisingly that 67% of the viewers believed that Trump won, with only 33% of the debate viewers believing that Biden won the debate. Looking at the election betting odds right now, which can be considered to be more accurate than the pollsters, shows that if the elections was held today, then Trump would win by a larger margin than in 2016, with 312 electoral votes going to Trump to Biden's 226 electoral votes. The current aggregate polls show that Trump is leading Biden by 2%, and there is a possibility that support for Trump could rise even more in the next weeks following the debate. The next debate is scheduled for September 10th and is going to be hosted by ABC News. UK has an upcoming general election, which is coming ever closer, and the results cannot be more than obvious. There's a 100% chance that the next government in the UK would be headed by the radical socialists from the Labour Party. And we can say that this is unfortunately going to happen, judging by the numerous polls which indicate that. The main reason behind this is that the Conservative Party has become incredibly unpopular in the UK, with the scandal after scandal and instability that followed. The UK has had three prime ministers in the span of 5 years. Due to this, the right wing of the United Kingdom has begun to unite around a familiar fellow of Nigel Farage, aka Mr. Brexit, who has returned to politics under the party of Reform UK. The support for the Reform UK has become so big in the past weeks that some polls show Reform beating the Tories in a popular vote and possibly winning dozens of seats. Due to this rise of actual right-wing populism in the UK, the corporate media, as it tends to do, starts demonizing Mr. Farage with anything that they can find or dig up on him. The absurdity of these libelous attacks have reached its peak recently, when British Channel 4 has done a hit piece on the Reform UK, filming an actor who has no connection to Nigel Farage or his party, saying incredibly racist things. Although the right wing in the UK is going through some hard times, I hope that our British brothers and sisters can move forward and bring common sense to Britain for once. As time goes on, I feel more and more embarrassed to say that I once was a big Star Wars fan, rewatching episode 1 to 6 a dozen of times and being fascinated by how vast the Star Wars universe was when I was a kid. However, now, especially after seeing how garbage the sequel trilogy was, I rarely if ever mention this part of my life. Sadly, things are going even worse now in the galaxy far, far away with the release of Acolyte. Judging by the fact that I made a YouTube poop of the trailer, you probably know my attitude towards this show. Yeah, it's bad. It's horrible. I want to address to you that I have no problem with adding LGBT and other identity nonsense to movies. I do not believe that anyone could infringe on anyone's rights of free speech and expression in culture and cinema. What I have to say is that the majority of people who watch sci-fi films and sci-fi adventure films like Star Wars or Star Trek are straight males who just want to watch a fun space adventure with a lot of action, and that's not my opinion, it's a fact. This can be confirmed by the fact that these films and series keep on flopping constantly all the time when they add some woke stuff to it. Perfect example of that can be seen with recent Indiana Jones film, the last Terminator film, and whatever the fuck Madam Web was. If you want to make a drama about gay black transsexuals, or a feminist movie, you do you. But if you put a label of action film on it, don't be surprised when it eventually flops, because nobody would want to watch it. Not action film fans, nor the fans who like deep, woke drama films. Well, that was it for the second episode of season 2 of the show. I hope you like it. Don't forget to leave a like and a sub for more videos like this one. Your support gives me will to continue posting this type of content. Don't forget to leave a comment on what topic you want me to discuss next. Mr. Grom, out.